Blackstone Publishing presents Written Out by Howard Mittelmark. This book is read by John Rubinstein. For Sandy, my actual genius novelist wife. Chapter 1. January 2015. I know this sounds overly dramatic, but returning to Long Island was like dying. Bear with me. There's a reason people move to New York when they're young, when they believe anything can happen, that magical things are waiting for them, that they're special. For some people, it turns out to be true. Even at my age, New York can have a quality of nascent possibility, the promise of unexpected and unpredictable encounters, whether romantic, artistic, or financial. It can make all of life seem numinous, if only sporadically, a series of choices and options glowing with potential, a forward-moving journey where you don't know what will happen next. Getting on the train in Penn Station, leaving New York City to move back to the Long Island town where I grew up, was the opposite of that. As the train chugged steadily eastward, getting ever closer to home, it was like a system shutting down piece by piece, synapse by synapse, the snuffing out of light, of hope, of vision. It was like being forced onto an ever narrower path, but fewer turns and escapes, like crawling ever further into a human lobster trap. Which, by the way, is the kind of thing you'd think someone who grew up here would be familiar with. A lobster trap, I mean, what with the stations being announced over the train's loudspeaker, names like Freeport and Seaford and Melville. But no, this wasn't a trip to the Long Island of 19th century whaling towns, nor was I headed to Fitzgerald's West Egg or the Lux Literary Hamptons. I was slinking back whence I came, to the ratty strip malls of Long Island's South Shore, to the petit bourgeois blue-collar suburbs, Levitt's crackerbox split levels. I'd run out of options, is the thing, and as Robert Frost said, home is the place where, when your mother is spending the winter in her condo in Florida and you know where she hides the key, you can stay until you figure something out. Or, as he might have said in his first draft, assuming he had a good editor, the value of which is hard to overestimate. I know this because I work as an editor, or did, until the publishing industry decided it could do just fine without me. Now, here I was getting off the LIRR at the Seaford train station, homeless, jobless, wifeless, hopeless. It was a sad and desolate place on a winter night, this train station, dark and gray, almost Soviet in its concrete utilitarian slabness. View from the elevated platform looking south, parking lot, Sunrise Highway, clot of fast food restaurants at the intersection, encrustation of low commercial buildings stretching out in either direction. Past them, residential subdivisions, like fields filled with crops of housing for the commutatariat. I went down the stairs and headed away from the lights of the station. The sound of traffic on Sunrise Highway was soon a whisper fading behind me. The streets I walked led past scrubby, winter-hard lawns, the suburban tundra, a light or two on in each house set behind them. Block after block, the only variation to my eye, habituated over decades to brightly lit city nights, was the shape and size of the SUVs parked in the driveways. The streets curved this way and that past the rows of slumbering homes, just enough to soften the planned grid and slow down the occasional car. I walked in the center of the street, just as I had as a kid, when I'd wander these streets with friends, hoping to find someone older to buy us beer. Just as we had then, I moved to the sidewalk when the lights of a car appeared in front of me, or approaching from behind, threw my long attenuated shadow ahead. I expected the house I arrived at to be fully dark, but not only was every window...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.